Hi, it's Mr. Andersen, and this is AP Biology Science Practice 7. The first time I read Science Practice 7, it really didn't make any sense to me. And so let me give you a reading and then see what you think. Science Practice 7, the student is able to connect and relate knowledge across various scales, concepts, and representations in and across domains. That sounds confusing, but I think what they're really trying to get at is they want you to be able to connect knowledge. And so this is Da Vinci. And Da Vinci had a lot of different jobs. He was a painter, sculptor, architect, musician, mathematician, engineer, inventor, anatomist, geologist, botanist, cartographer, and writer. In other words, he brought together all of these different disciplines. And that was common back then. But today, we've tended to isolate in each of our different disciplines. If you're a biologist, you really concern yourself just with biology. And that's changing. In other words, we want you to be able to make these connections and connections of scale. And what do I mean by scale? We want you to be able to understand how biology works at the very small scale, at the medium scale, and at the very large scale. What's something at the small scale? That's just going to be molecules. We want you to also be able to understand scale as far as time span that is just microseconds all the way up to geologic time. And also we want you to be able to understand complexity from things that are very simple to things that are almost infinitely complex like the human mind. And so when we're saying connecting across all of these different scales, if I were to say this is DNA, DNA is going to be really small. It's not going to be that complex. It's made up of a few different atoms, and then it's going to operate on a very small time scale. But they want you to be able to apply that across this whole scale. So if we're looking at an ecosystem like that, ecosystems evolved over, you know, thousands and thousands of years. They're made up of organisms. Those organisms contain DNA. And so that DNA has been passed along all the way through this time span. And so we can go from the very simple to the very complex, and they want you to be able to understand that. Or another example, let's say we have this. This is simply chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is one molecule, but could you apply how chlorophyll affects everything up to the level of the carbon cycle? In other words, how plants are taking in carbon, how they're making use of chlorophyll to harness the power of the sun. And so that's what they mean by senses of scale and making those connections. And also when they say domains, what they really mean is outside of biology. So thermodynamics is physics, really, but we apply it by understanding that all energy comes from the sun, it's converted through photosynthesis, and then we make use of that in our food. Or biochemistry, understanding how a phospholipid is going to have a hydrophilic head and hydrophobic tail allows us better to understand at a more complex scale how a cell membrane works. Or if we understand how diffusion works, which is essentially chemistry, then we really can understand how nutrients, molecules, gases, all these things are moving around inside life. And so connecting it across domains means not only using biology, but chemistry and mathematics as well. And so at each of the different four big ideas, they want you to be able to apply this connection of all these scales and concepts. And so if we're looking at the peppered moths or natural selection, to really understand that, we have to understand what happened over time. So we have a change in the time scale. We're really looking at genes. And if we don't understand genetics, we really can't understand evolution. We're looking at free energy. Free energy and understanding feedback loops is important, but understanding how those different feedback loops are going to allow organisms to survive in different environments, or if we're looking at information, this is a great story. This is the Himalayan rabbit. Himalayan rabbits are always going to be white, except if we have a change in their environment. And so the temperature in the ears and the nose and the feet cause them to express different genes. And if you were to put a piece of ice on the back of this rabbit right here, you could actually shave the rabbit and then change that to have a black patch on the back. And so that's expressing different genes depending on environmental cues. And that has a lot to do with the histones that the DNA wraps around. Or if we're looking at cotton, at the very small scale, understanding how the sugars are built is important. But understanding how those sugars are attached together to create cellulose gives us a totally different molecule. It's just like sugar, but it's connected in such a way that If you eat cotton, it's not going to be like eating sugar. And so they really only want you to be able to do two things. They want you to be able to connect phenomena across models of spatial and temporal scale. Remember, spatial is where they are, temporal is at what time. So here's an example of a multiple choice question. They're telling you that sickle cell anemia results from a point mutation in a specific gene. It results in a misplacement or replacement of amino acid that has a hydrophilic R group. So which of the following would likely result? And so you could pause the video and take a stab at this if you want to. Okay, you could work your way through it. So I could eliminate a lot of these. I know we're not talking about DNA structure here or fatty acid. So I know I'm dealing with proteins since we're replacing an amino acid. So I'm now kind of down to A or D. I could eliminate D because it's saying the protein's secondary structure as a result of interactions between R groups. And so R groups, remember, aren't going to affect us until we get to the tertiary structure of a protein, so I would choose A as the right. They also want you to be able to connect concepts in and across domains, and so this is one where they're asking you to look at a negative feedback loop in the endocrine system, and so they give four different alternative correct answers for negative feedback. We could start looking at these across, you know, now we're looking at different forms of anatomy. So here we're looking at, this would be a nervous response. This is a genetic response. And so I could kind of pare it down to these two, which are going to be related to the endocrine system. And then the only one that's going to have negative feedback would be B. This would be a positive feedback up here at the top. So again, the questions that they're giving as examples of connecting their domains are not super hard. They just want you to not get stuck in the specifics that it's going to cross several different domains. And so a good way to get at this is a game that I like to play in my class. It's called the Wiki Game. So what you do is you log on to Wikipedia and you try to make connections between one concept and another. There's some rules, like you can't use the search box, you can't go outside and do links outside that or visit external websites, can't go back, can't hit backspace, can't click on dates, can't use search tools, can't use like find F. And what you try to do is to get from concept to concept to concept, just going through and making connections in the links of Wikipedia. And so could you do that? Could you connect from peppered moth feedback, cellulose, Himalayan rabbits? I think it took me about 38 links to get from peppered moth to feedback loops to cellulose and to Himalayan rabbits. Maybe you could do better. You could put your connections down in the comments down below if you can beat my score of 38. But that's really what we're talking about. We're connecting across different sizes, complexity, time scale, and even domains. And I hope that was helpful.